Before I will ask Father Scott to speak for us, I'll just share some short introduction for him to those who know him. Scott family is from the United States of America, from North Carolina. And God has placed a burden to Brother Scott to minister here in Denmark some few years ago. And eventually God has directed him to work here as a missionary. And before going here to Denmark, he has visited a lot of churches over the United States. That's what we call the missionary invitation. Visit churches and share the burden with the heart of the missionary to where God has called him. And he has traveled a lot of states, perhaps the whole states of America, almost 50?
Over half.
Over half of the states for 23 months. 23 months traveling around the U.S., sharing to different churches. Me as a missionary also has been involved in that short invitation where I was there for only 2 or 3 weeks and had visited about 9 different states in the U.S. It was very short leave, but God has prepared in another way for the support of the mission here many years ago. And today, we are so glad to hear him, and many of you have already come in contact with them since they came here last September, and we are so thankful to God for the approval of their missionary visa. They're still waiting for their CPR number, though they have the number, but they need a card. And and as well as we are praying concerning for the eldest daughter, Christina, that the government will allow her to stay until August this year before she will go join the college in California. And the church has decided that Brother Scott will speak to us last December, Christmas, Thanksgiving. But he has already involvement on that time period and in the evening, so instead of hearing him last December, so we will hear him this New Year time. So we thank the Lord for this opportunity and the privilege to hear the servant of the Lord.
Happy New Year!
Happy New Year!
I really enjoy this time of year, and the reason I enjoy New Year's is because it symbolizes a fresh start and getting a new, fresh start and look at things. I know I'm thankful for the fresh start the Lord Jesus Christ gave each one of us in salvation that knows Jesus Christ. As we became a new creature in Christ Jesus. And how many is glad for that new start? Amen. To be a new creature. So it's a privilege to be a child of God, to know the Lord Jesus Christ as Savior. And this time of year is just a great time. I know my family and I have been discussing different plans that we each had of reading through the Bible this year. And get to start that way in Bible reading. And I hope you've made some commitment to the Lord this new year.
Amen.
And get a fresh start in things serving Jesus and living for Him. And what a blessing this time of year is. Before I begin, let me say, one, I hope everyone can understand me well. Pastor mentioned that, of course, a lot of you know this by now, that we're from North Carolina in the U.S., and that is in the southern part of the U.S. We are typically known as southerners in the United States for speaking very slow. Unlike whom we would refer to in the south as Yankees, those that live up north in the United States, they speak very fast. Da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da. And sometimes hard to keep up with how they talk. Texans. How many are familiar with Texans? They basically real slow and talk for us. North Carolina is known for being very slow speakers. So I hope that's a help and not a hindrance in listening to me today. But nonetheless, I hope you'll tune in to this North Carolina preacher and listen intently today. And not listen just to hear me personally or because I'm standing here, but because God's Word is being given forth today. Please remove all distractions. I know some use electronic devices for maybe reference to your Bible. That's fine. I know folks do that nowadays. We live in an electronic age. But please don't let your electronic device or anything else, maybe even what you're thinking about after church today or your schedule this week, don't let anything during the service be a distraction to you. Tune your heart, your mind to listen to the Word of God today. Because I know God's laid a message on my heart, and I know it's for you, so you need to listen. Not just because of me. I say that even as Brother Kalba stands each week and speaks and preaches. We need to listen. It's God's man. It's God's message. And we need to tune our hearts and our minds into the message, what God's trying to say to us. One other thing I want to say before we get started, and you have the reference in the paper that was given. John chapter 1 is where we'll begin today. But before I begin, I don't know if I have adequate words to express my heart. Ecclesiastes says that the preacher sought out acceptable words. And I don't know if I have the vocabulary to express my heart. But my family and I, we are so truly grateful for this congregation. And I've even learned how to say the proper title, CBMBC. Pastor Kalba, you and your family and the folks here at this church, you just don't know what a blessing you've been to our family. We were strangers in a strange land as we came off of a plane September 22nd. This past year, and there was a group of people here that made us feel at home. That means a lot to us. And you guys will always have a very special place in our family's heart. Let me put it like this. CBMBC was God's specific answer to many prayers that we have prayed. We did not know of anyone that could sponsor us into the country as a missionary. And God used you all to answer that prayer. We're grateful, and I mean that. And thank you for the warm welcome we received with the decorations and the cake from the very first night, even though we were late, running around the city, lost in Copenhagen. There was at one point in trying to find our way here that I almost gave up and said, well, we'll try to catch you the next Sunday. And we came on, somewhat frustrated that we were so late, and came to a standing ovation of people that welcomed us. I told you I wouldn't have the adequate words, but I'm trying to express my heart of how much you guys mean to us. And we thought we'd rent a vehicle for a week, and this is maybe the naive missionary coming from the U.S., and I thought I would come and rent a car from the airport for a week and then buy a vehicle within the first week. Found out when I got here, we're not allowed to buy a vehicle within a week. We have to have that thing called a CPR number.
What?
And again, you all were an answer to prayer. I've told this testimony to churches and folks that I've talked to within the United States, people that support us. And I've told them about you. I've told them how God has used you, how what God's done through you to help us. And I said, there's this guy in the church that just so happened to have a 7-passenger vehicle that we could use until we get our CPR number. How many people just have a 7-passenger vehicle? Guess what? We have 7 members in our family. Brother Tarot, God used you, and I know you don't want public recognition for that, but God used you in our life. You're grateful. God's been good to the Suttle family. And we want to thank you as God's people for being a part of that as we come. Continue to pray. We do want to see, of course, a regular place that we can meet and worship in the north of Hillroot and establish the work there and see people saved and have a place that we can regularly meet and bring folks to church. That is a burden of our heart. That's why we're here in the country. We obviously enjoy coming here and being with you all, the fellowship. But God has obviously called us here to start work and see people saved and to raise up something else. And please pray for us as we launch out and get started with that this new year. And pray God's direction in all those endeavors. All right, John chapter number 1. We better get started with the message. From the U.S., I was raised, I grew up around many different kinds of preaching. I was raised as a young boy around very animated preaching. I was raised in the mountains of North Carolina around what we refer to as country preachers that literally they would be dripping, Pastor Caldwell, with sweat after a message. Their ties would be wet because they exerted so much excitement and energy during a message. And then I've been around those that have been very calm and very dignified, I guess would be a good word for that, and not get animated in their preaching. So I'm accustomed to many different styles of preaching. And you know what? I'm thankful for all of them. Because I know God calls and God uses different kinds of people to reach different kinds of people. And God can use you. God can use who God wants you to be in your community, around your people, and the way God wants you to be used. That's why we're individuals, and I'm thankful for that. So if my preaching style is a little different than maybe you're accustomed to, or I just want you to know, everybody don't have to be the same. It's the Word of God that counts. Pastor Paul would tell you, I'm sure first before anybody would, that he and I are just vessels. We're just instruments to be used of the Lord. It's Jesus. It's His Word that counts. That's what matters. It's this book. Let's turn to John chapter number 1, and I'll begin reading in verse number 1. The Bible says this, John chapter 1, verse number 1. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. The same was in the beginning with God. All things were made by Him, and without Him was not anything made that was made. In Him was life, and the life was the light of men. And the light shineth in darkness, and the darkness comprehended it not. Now if we look on to verse number 10 in the same chapter, the Bible says, He was in the world, and the world was made by him. That's the Word. That's Jesus Christ. And the world knew him not. He came unto his own, and his own received him not. But as many as received him, to them gave he power to become the sons of God, even to them that believe on his name, which were born not of blood, nor of the will of the flesh, nor of the will of man, but of God. And the Word was made flesh and dwelt among us, and we beheld his glory, the glory as of the only begotten of the Father, full of grace and truth. Now here's the message. Giving Jesus his proper place in 2016. Giving Jesus his proper place. Let's pray before the message. Father, we love you. We thank you for this day to be gathered in your house to listen to your word. Lord, we pray that our hearts would be open to receive what you have for us. Lord, I pray that your word would not at all return void, but each heart would be good ground that the seed of the word of God could fall upon and find root and grow. Lord, I pray that you would help us to see your truth clearly today. We ask it in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. I asked this question before we begin today, and I want you to think seriously about this question. How many of you truly want to be a better Christian and live for Jesus better this year than you did last year? Let me see your hand. How many wants to live for Jesus, be a better Christian this next year? Many hands all over the auditorium. Listen, I want to be a better Christian than I was in 2015. So to do that, I want us to look today at the Word of God of how we can give Jesus his proper place in our lives. First of all, let's look at the text in John chapter number 1. The Bible says, in the beginning was the Word. That is a capital W, Word. And the Word, there's another capital letter to begin that word, Word. Was with God. And the Word, capital W, or capital letter to begin the Word, was God. The same was in the beginning with God. That same Word in verse number 14, and the Word, capital letter, was made flesh and dwelt among us. That is Jesus Christ. I believe in our day, in our generation, there are many people that have the wrong perspective of Jesus Christ and who Jesus truly is. Many religions have labeled Jesus as just a teacher, which he was a teacher, but he's more than that. People have referred to Jesus as a good man, or maybe the leader of a nation, or of his people, the Jews. And yes, he was, but he's more than that. Jesus is the Savior of the world. Jesus Christ, as we see in this text, was God manifest in the flesh. Do we believe that? Amen. That's called the deity of Jesus Christ. And Jesus Christ is God that was manifest in the flesh. That's good doctrine. That's giving Jesus his proper doctrinal place in the Word of God. And you have the references here in John chapter number 1. Another thing we see in John chapter number 1 about Jesus is that he was the creator of all things. Yes, God in three persons, the Father, as 1 John 5 would tell us, the Father, the Word, and the Holy Ghost, these three are one. That's the doctrine of the Trinity. We believe that God is three persons, Father, Son, and Holy Ghost. That's good doctrine, and that's the Bible, and we believe that, and we teach that. Do you believe that? Say amen.
Amen.
That's giving Jesus his proper place. You know, in Genesis chapter number 1, the account of the creation, the Bible says that God said, let us, plural, let us make man in our image. The Bible says that. A plurality of God, Father, Son, explained in 1 John, the Holy Ghost. Those three are one. That's giving Jesus. You know, there's a lot of even religious groups don't teach that. But we give Jesus his rightful place scripturally and doctrinally because we believe the Bible. You know, what is our faith without the Bible? What is your life without the Bible? The Word of God needs to have a preeminent place in your life. It should not just be a book you throw on the bookshelf when you get home from church and not ever look at it again until the next time you come. Is everybody with me? Nod your head. Amen. The Bible ought to be of utmost importance in our lives because it tells us about our Savior. It tells us about Jesus. He's important. He's what we live for. Our lives are about Him. Now, giving Jesus His proper place, we see the doctrine of His deity and of the Trinity and that He was the Creator of all things. Colossians chapter 1 says He is before all things, and by Him, that's Jesus, by Him all things consist. I believe it was Father, Son, and Holy Ghost in the beginning, God created all things. Now, something else about Jesus. The Bible says that when the fullness of time was come, God sent forth His Son, made of a woman, made under the law. I believe in giving Jesus His proper place, I believe this is the same Jesus that had a miracle birth. The Old Testament in Isaiah 7 refers to it as the virgin birth. Also in Matthew chapter number 1, and that's another great doctrine of the Scripture. And giving Jesus His proper place, we believe that Jesus Christ is the virgin-born Son of God. That's giving Jesus His proper place doctrinally. You believe that? Nod your head at me. I'll make sure you're still awake, okay? That's His proper place. There's a lot of people and liberal theologians that would say it was just a young woman and other versions of the Bible. I like the old King James Bible that we have in English. Other versions would teach and change that portion of Scripture that a young woman. There's no miracle in a young woman giving birth to the Son. That happens every day. But the Bible says it was a virgin that gave birth. Now that's a miracle. That which was conceived in Mary was of the Holy Ghost. As Acts says, Jesus had flowing through His body God's blood. That's a miracle. And that's my Jesus. That's the Savior of the Bible. A different perspective than what a lot of people have in their minds about Jesus. Why did Jesus come into the world? Well, I'm glad you asked. 1 Timothy 1. This is a faithful saying and worthy of all acceptation that Christ Jesus came into the world to save sinners. That's why Jesus came. And the proper place for Jesus is that He is to be proclaimed in this world as the Bible proclaims Him as the Savior of the world. Jesus is the Savior. Jesus came to save people from their sin And listen, there may be in a congregation this size someone that is still yet in your sin that needs to know Jesus personally as your Savior. Jesus came for you. He came for me. He came to die for sinners. And that's why He came. That's the Jesus of the Bible. That's giving Jesus His proper place. Also, we see that Jesus lived a sinless life. That He who knew no God, He who was without sin, walked upon this earth 33 years and went to an old rugged cross. And there He hung between heaven and earth upon that cross, and He died for your sin and mine as He shed His precious blood on that cross. He did that for you, and He did that for me. That's the Savior. That's the Jesus of the Bible. That should be the centerpiece of our lives. It's Jesus. Is that the Jesus you serve? Amen. That's the Jesus of the Bible. He not only died that cruel death on the cross, He was buried. And thank the Lord, on the third day, death could not hold Him. He rose victorious over death, hell, and the grave. That's my Jesus. He's a living Savior. You say, why do you have a living or lively hope? Because I have a resurrected living Savior. Because He lives, I can live. Because He lives, we can have life and have it more abundantly. That's the Jesus of the Bible. Not a Jesus that's just the centerpiece of dead religion. No, Jesus is more than a religious figure. He lives in my heart. That's the Savior of the Bible. Too much religion is filled up with just a dead religious figure. Jesus is a living Savior. That's the Jesus of the Bible. People think about Jesus in many ways. Maybe some think about Jesus as that one that hangs on the crucifix in their car. Maybe it's some picture they have hung in a special place. But the Jesus of the Bible rose from the dead. He's no longer on the cross. The Bible says after those 40 days of ministering to His disciples and walking on this earth that He ascended to heaven. And the Bible says those two men in white apparel, those angels that stood by the disciples, said, "Why stand you gazing here to heaven? This same Jesus which you have seen go into heaven shall so come in like manner as you've seen Him go into heaven." Listen, Jesus is at the right hand of God there to make intercession for you and I according to the book of Hebrews. That's the Jesus of the Bible. Giving Jesus His proper place. Now, I know time is quickly getting away from us, and I want to get you can ask my family. Sometimes my introduction is a lot longer than my message. But here, all that being said by way of introduction, stay with me. I don't want to lose you on that comment, okay? With all that being said, you and I in this church building today can have all of our doctrine